So, yeah, before we go anywhere further, I guess it's time, Fringy.
Oh, okay.
I suppose you're welcome to provide all the context you want and take the lead, but chat,
Okay.
you're in for an adventure.
So, when after I think while I was watching Buffy and Angel with Mauler, part of the idea was like, all right, you show me one of the shows that you think is good, I'll show you one of the shows that I think is good. And the show that I elected to get Mauler to watch was BoJack Horseman. Prior to watching BoJack Horseman again over the last couple of weeks, my perspective on the show was that it was really good. Like I had quite a favorable view of that show. I hadn't rewatched any of the seasons past season three, and I think season three came out like in 2016, so it had been a while since I had like properly rewatched them, but I had seen them all and I had a really favorable view. So we started watching BoJack Horseman, and we sort of kept going and going, and by season three, I was starting to get very frustrated with the show. And so, after all of that, we get to the end, and my perspective on BoJack Horseman is not only is it not a good show, it's actually bad. It
Oh God,
was
here we
quite an
go.
adventure. Do we want to like run through the so part of the problem is like I feel like talking about the comedy is something that we need to come to later. I think the fundamental thing to address. So when you watch BoJack Horseman from beginning to end, like if you watch all of the seasons back to back, one of the things that you will notice about that show is that it has a very rigid formula that it follows and that it goes through every like repeatedly. So the big, broader formula for this show is if you break it down by each of the seasons, excluding season six, but only to a certain extent, episode one is like, this is what this season will be about. And then episodes two through usually about eight or nine are largely unimportant and nothing particularly important happens when it comes to the main BoJack story. Then by episode 9 to 10, things will usually get a little bit more, important. Episode 11 in every single season, like the penultimate episode of every season, is like the dark episode, the drama episode. And without fail, it's usually the best episode of the season. But again, like to say that those episodes would be good is like, the only one that I think is good is The View from Halfway Down, the second last episode of the entire show. But every single season does that. And then season 12 usually brings it right back down. We're right back into comedy. We rarely like address all of the important stuff that happened in the episode before. And then we sort of have our lead in into the next season. And that is the formula every single season. And once you start to notice it, it kind of becomes impossible to ignore. And the only time that it changes is in season six, because that one has more episodes. But you could argue that the formula is the same, just extended. And between those drama moments, which let's get real, guys, that was the stuff that people are interested in. I would like to believe that people weren't watching the show for the comedy, because I don't think I ever was. But my view of we'll get to the comedy later. But one of the things that you notice when you rewatch the show is that the ratio of drama to comedy is it's like 90% comedy, 10% drama. And the drama was like what I thought I liked about the show, and I thought that there was more of it, and there isn't. There's really not. It's mostly just jokes, and most of the jokes are not that great. Damn, like I feel like and the drama is like even deficient. It becomes more deficient as it goes on. Like starting up with season one and two, the drama for BoJack is like working. It's fine, if not a lot of it. But then the more that it continues to go, it starts to break down because they keep adding on new things while ignoring the things that they had already set up, until right at the very end when it all just gets heaped on in a very contrived way. And then when it comes to every other character, we don't have a lot at all. Princess Carolyn would probably be like the second most developed character, and even then there's a lot of stuff that we skip over. There's a lot of content that we just don't it feels like there are a lot of scenes that are missing. And then when it comes to the last three, which is Diane, Mr. Peanut Butter, and Todd, Mr. Peanut Butter and Todd could almost be excluded from the show and very little would change. I mean, obviously a lot would change in terms of like the relationships with the other characters, but the things that they've got going on is so minimal that it honestly feels that the further we get into the show, the less they know what they want to do with him. Todd basically exists to go on these crazy, wacky adventures that are totally unrelated to the main plot. Mr. Peanut Butter is usually just like, look at me, I'm a stupid doggo, and I'm gonna cause shenanigans. And then Diane, who I think by the end of the season has been completely obliterated, the end of the show, completely obliterated. Basically, it's the same situation as Britta, except she is meant to be taken very seriously, and is basically places herself on a very high pedestal. The show forgets that she wrote a best-selling book many times. So yeah, really, all you've got is BoJack, who is without a doubt the best character in the show, mainly because he has things going on. But even then, his parents are cartoonishly evil. There's a line when BoJack, he smokes a cigarette because he's a kid, and he smokes it, and then his mom walks in and tells him to keep smoking it, and he asks, is this because I stole the cigarette? And she said, no, it's because you're alive. Like, how can you listen to a line like that and take that seriously? It's so cartoonishly evil. And then there's a scene where BoJack's dad gets caught having an affair, and so he gives BoJack alcohol to knock him out, and BoJack is like 7 or 8 years old. And when he's driving home, he's like, yeah, you probably don't want to tell your mom about any of this, do you? And this is meant to be like really dramatic moments. and a lot of the ideas that they have for BoJack, that you realize that's in character for Beach. I'm sorry. It's cartoonishly evil. And this is a show where it's meant to have the serious stakes. And in terms of like Beatrice as well, I think that's an opportunity that was thoroughly undermined. Because, like, we have our episode where we find out that the reason why Beatrice is cartoonishly evil is because her mom had a nervous breakdown, and then when she got a lobotomy, she told her, point blank, don't love anybody, otherwise you'll end up like me and have part of your brain cut out. That's effectively what we got. It's set, there is no subtext, it's all text in this entire show. It's all text. There's never any double meaning to any of the sentences. People always say what they mean. People always say what they mean in this show. It's astounding how many scenes there are where the characters just outright blurt out exactly what they mean. And then the piano music kicks in as they talk about, like, you have a scene where it's comedy, and then all of a sudden BoJack will be like, I don't know how to feel happy. You know, I just wish that I could feel happy, but I can't. And or then you have a scene with Princess Carolyn where it's like, I don't know, I'm really good at my job, but I want to have a kid, and I don't know, it's very confusing. But that you have scenes like that, and then you have the same with basically all of the characters in the show. one of the things that you notice when you watch the show through again is that the ideas that they have are fine, if not, you know, potentially good. Specifically for BoJack, I'm talking about BoJack now specifically. You have a lot of ideas that could work. The idea of, you know, a washed up actor who has a whole bunch of money, but yet is miserable and can't figure out why. I mean, that's a great idea. But we skip over so much content. We get so little of like the really cool ideas. We only get like a few episodes with Herb when that could have been a whole season. We only get a few episodes with Sarah Lynn when that could have been a whole season. We only get a few episodes with Beatrice when that could be a whole season. And then we have things where we totally skip over content that we have. So for instance, Herb only gets one episode and then he dies, And not only, and this character had cancer, but he gets over the cancer and dies because he crashes into a truck that's filled with peanuts, and he's allergic to peanuts. And he was tweeting, "Oh no, I'm allergic to peanuts," when he crashed into it. Apparently, that was what was said at the funeral. And then we don't have much with him at all after that. Sarah Lynn has this whole big episode about 2 minutes before she dies. We finally get some information on what is actually going on in her mind, and then she dies. And then the next episode jumps immediately into this completely contrived sequence where, oh no, character actress Margot Martindale has caused a blimp that has the Secretariat poster to have a blinding glare that causes two ships to crash into each other. Oh no, wait, no, the ships crash, they've got a bunch of spaghetti, the Secretariat poster, which is a mirror, shoots a bunch of light onto the spaghetti. Oh no, the spaghetti's cooking. Now it's going to sink and crush the ocean town. If only there was somebody who had a bunch of spaghetti strainers, and if only there was somebody who had created this really elaborate Uber-type business that could deliver these spaghetti strainers to the ocean to save this city. Ho ho, funny, funny. Meanwhile, this has come after the, up to this point, the most dramatic moment throughout the entire show. Like,
People keep saying, to be fair, these things are supposed to be jokes. That's Friggy's point.
That's the point. Like, you have what arguably one of the most significant people in BoJack's life die in a very bad way, and the episode which follows only gives us about 2 to 3 minutes of BoJack. We don't see him immediately on the aftermath. We don't see the funeral. We don't really see how he's dealing with it at all. But then 3 seasons later, it comes back in a really significant way. And also the way that it comes back doesn't make sense, because the whole story builds up to this realization that BoJack lied about the circumstances of Sarah Lynn's death. But there's no way that that couldn't have been the case, because BoJack went on a month-long bender with her. Pictures were taken of him. He showed up in several different locations, but the show acts like nobody could connect the dots. He's a super famous Golden Globe-winning movie star. It's insane.
Yeah, he almost got the Oscar, except funny shenanigans.
That's right. He almost won the Oscar, except that Mr. Peanut Butter lost the cud that had the nominees for Best Actor. And so they go on this massive adventure, and apparently he just makes up the list of nominees as though the Oscars don't actually have a list of their predetermined nominees, as if they don't have more than one cut. Is Fringy literally complaining about how slice of life shows are structured? I'm sorry, my dude. If you have an episode where the most significant character, my problem is Fringy's claim that it's objectively bad when all of his criticisms are subjective. How is it subjective that it is a bizarre tone shift to have the most significant character in a person's life die, only to immediately jump into this insane contrived joke scenario and spend no time on what that character, like, talk about wasting your drama. And that is the most disappointing thing coming into the show again, which is how much of the drama was wasted. There were so many opportunities where they could have done more, they could have expanded upon it more, but then we get nothing. It's just completely swept under the rug.
There is a cosmic amount of plot holes if people really want us to go to those. But
yeah,
might want to bring up the two episodes.
Which ones are we talking about? So there are two episodes. There are these two episodes that are astoundingly bad. It is definitely a result of the fact that the show's main method of relaying information to you is that characters say exactly what they mean all of the time, and there's never any subtext. It's a big formula for the jokes, which we'll get to later, but these two episodes are, there's a gun control episode and an episode called BoJack the Feminist. Yeah, so in the gun control episode, the main thesis is that America hates women more than it loves guns, and hence they ban all the guns because it makes women feel safer having them. That is, like, the point of that episode.
Go watch it, guys. People who love BoJack Horseman, really watch that fucking episode. It's if women get guns, men will be afraid of them, and thus old white men in power will ban guns as a whole to prevent women from having them to feel safer. And the ending conclusion and you could say this is entirely played for jokes. It's not any kind of commentary whatsoever. Is America hates women more than it loves guns? It's like, okay.
Yeah, that is literal dialogue, by the way. That's not like something that we've invented or paraphrased. Oh, yeah, because that is the line of dialogue in the show.
So I've only seen one episode of BoJack, and that was the episode I saw. I have no feelings toward the show either way. But I did get shown this episode, and it is probably one of the worst television episodes of anything that I have ever seen. It was like, I wanted to bail on it. I didn't want to finish it. I didn't laugh at anything. It was super cringy. The message was so stupid and on the nose. Everything was just blatant and in your face.
Well, yeah, because when you watch the episode, they have these like I don't know what they're called. I think it's called Vox Pops in media, you know, where you talk to regular people to get their opinion. You have a bunch of characters who are men who are like Vox Pops. I think that's what they I think that's what the segment's called, Vox Pops, like for news media when they do it. And it's basically a bunch of guys just saying these insanely caricatured points. They have no intention of presenting a level-headed episode on this topic where everybody, you know, where they're actually trying to represent both perspectives on the issue and address it. It just feels like a lecture. And whether or not you agree with, you know, the thesis of the episode, whether or not more gun control is necessary or less, whether or not you agree with it, I think if you would watch it, you would be it's astounding. And then, you know, that's the same issue with the episode in the next season, BoJack the Feminist. That episode was really significant for the plot as well. But the whole point of the episode is there's this actor who 5 years ago had done some bad thing, you know, sexual assault or something like that. He's making a comeback. And Diane is really pissed off about it because it's the idea of like, why does he get to come back and continue to have a career? So she gets ambushed in this car by a character called Anna Spanakopita, who was like BoJack's. She was helping him try to get the Oscar. And now she's trying to help this particular actor have his career back. And then she asks BoJack, she asks Diane a question along the lines of what is he, he's done the bad thing. What is he supposed to do now? Like, what does he do? Is he, you know, akin to the question of, is he supposed to like die? Is he supposed to never be able to work again? What is he supposed to do? She doesn't answer that question. And the question is never answered, even though it's a really valid question to ask. What were the other problems? Because that episode had a lot of problems.
Specifically the feminist one?
Yeah, BoJack the Feminist, that episode.
Didn't you show a few... there was a scene you actually wanted to replay
as
we were in
a
call.
There was a scene at the end of the episode where... So BoJack is on a show called Philbert. And the whole idea with Philbert is that it's meant to be like a... it's meant to be this subversive show... and so he shows Diane the BoJack shows Diane the script, and she says that it's sexist because it was like masquerading as a commentary on these sexist tropes, but also committing them. And then I think there's a line where because BoJack is trying to be like a super feminist, you know, to improve his image, he's doing it very cynically. And then I think Diane says, this isn't a hobby for me. Being a woman isn't a hobby for me. And then she says something along the lines of, you know, you or some guy being able to come along and pretend to be and play Joss Whedon. And then, you know, go basically the point being Joss Whedon only comes in to play pretend feminist and then go back to being a piece of shit. That was like the point that they were trying to make, which of course is funny when having watched Buffy and Angel, those shows have some of the best female characters in like any media ever. And Joss Whedon wrote it. And the show does it a lot where they criticize other shows for doing things, and it's like, man, glass houses. BoJack is objectively great. One of the best comedies I've seen. All right, can we talk? Let's talk about the comedy. BoJack Horseman
Tell them how many times I laughed in the totality of the six seasons.
I don't think you laughed at all.
Which is pretty fucking funny, isn't it?
I didn't even want to finish the one episode of mine. It was just so shockingly unfunny.
For reference, I laughed 4 times in the newest episode of The Simpsons that I watched as an experiment.
Well, yeah, because, I mean, it, for example, you get more laughs in like 50 seconds of classic Simpsons than we got in, because I think I didn't laugh more than 5 times rewatching it.
They make the same jokes again and again and again and again. It's fucking nuts.
That's the thing that becomes apparent. And you know, interestingly enough, right, before I recommended the show to you, Mola, I think I even mentioned that I didn't think the comedy was the show's strong suit, but like, my God, rewatching it again. So the jokes tend to fall into one of 3 or 4 categories. One of the most common jokes is a Freudian slip, where a character accidentally just says what they actually think. You know, it'll be like, are you nervous? No, what? I'm not nervous. I'm not nervous that this could all secretly go wrong and reveal my deep-seated insecurities. Definitely not that. That is a very common joke in this show. At least once an episode, I would almost wager, you will see a joke that is like that. It's basically just a character saying what they mean but pretending like it's not. Freudian slip, that's joke number one.
Can I pause
number
you? Just
two sec, I'm doing the
one,
Biden
one,
thing here
one sec maniacal foreigner. I'm gonna read this is directed for me, but I'd happily have you answer it, Friggy. Mola, what do you like about Joss Whedon? All of his characters are exactly the same. Wise cracking,
no,
smug, and quirky.
They're not the same.
Have you finished either show? No, they're not.
How could... Oh, yeah. Angel and Fred. Identical. Nothing
well,
different
let's,
about them at all.
I mean, cause Angel and Spike. Because Theo's seen that. Yeah, like those, and Spike, yeah. Those two, yeah. they're practically the same, right?
Yeah.
Giles and Cordelia, practically the same.
Yeah.
Buffy and Willow are identical.
I'm sorry to interrupt. It's the thing a lot of people say to me. It's like his characters are all the same. And I'm like, I don't understand that one.
they're not the same. But yeah. So what was I was doing the Biden thing. So Freudian slips. Number one. Number two. Another one of the very common jokes in this show is extremely long sentences. Like the joke is that a character is saying something really long. For instance, one of the shows, and this is a joke that gets done several times. They get the guy who wrote Catcher in the Rye to make a TV show. And the joke for the TV show is that the name of the show is Hollywood Stars and Celebrities. What do they know? Do they know things? Let's find out. That's the joke. It's a long sentence. BoJack has a sister and her name is Holly Hawk. And then she has 8 names afterwards because she has 8 dads. And so the joke is that her name is really hard to remember. In fact, I think the first episode where she jumps in, they repeat that joke several times where it's just like, oh, my name is Hollyhock, something, 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 something. Oh, and also there's a conglomerate that's called like Time Warner, Pepsi, Toyota, Trader Joe, something, something. It's like 10 different companies merged together. And that's the joke. And then they do that joke over. And you know, you can be like, oh, the joke is that it's a conglomerate. And it's like... Okay, I mean, there's not much depth to a joke like that, is it? Look, big conglomerate, isn't this insane? And then you do it like 7 or 8 times again. You know what I mean? Like, so yeah, really long jokes. Another one of the common jokes is either rhymes or alliteration. So like, and this is mainly a Princess Carolyn thing, where the joke is that it's a very long sentence again, but it's either alliterated or it rhymes, or there's some other frenetic thing, and that's the joke. And then I think the fourth last major type of joke in this is a pun. This show is riddled with puns. The amount of puns in this show is unbelievable. And usually all it is just an animal name substituted for, like, you know, a person. What Manity Fair was one of them. I think it was Maggot Gyllenhaal is another one, you know, for, yeah, basically you're just substituting a name that sounds kind of similar, to, you know, an animal. And of course, like, you look at that and you might think that that's clever, like, oh, look, they're finding names that rhyme, but I don't think you realize how, like, easy it is to come up with these types of puns. One of the times where it became really apparent was BoJack was in this episode where he was arguing with someone from the LA Gazette. And I think I just offhandedly said, oh, I didn't call it the LA Gazelle. And when I did that, I was like, oh, is that how easy it is to come up with puns? Just as long as you have a vocabulary that's broad enough, you'll be able to just make puns. And remember, puns are not like puns are not exactly like the highest form of comedy to start off with. So when puns
unless
are like the
mine.
Backbone,
puns are great.
Unless they're right.
Yeah. Well, what was it? It was a joke from Archer where it was like puns are the lowest form of comedy. I'm not sure if I want to commit to that position. Seal McBeal, the Navy Seal. Yeah, that's another one. And it's not that great when it's just happening all the time. And again, you compare it to, you know, I've been rewatching a lot of old Simpsons episodes. Just think about like how clever the joke is that is you didn't like the oh yeah the Halloween store that's in January. That was the joke. Oh damn it! You guys remember the episode of The Simpsons where Bart is like he's just come out of church and he needs to cause some havoc because he spent a long time in Sunday school, and then he sees Willie doing a thing for Scotch-toberfest. He goes up, ties a bunch of balloons to his kilt, and it lifts his kilt up. A woman faints when he sees his schlong, and Willie's like, "There's no chance of being upset about what God gave you." And then Bart just sort of is like, "Oh yeah, there we go. That's the stuff." And then a bunch of like FBI agents pop out of the trees and like the bird water fountain. And then Skinner walks up and is like, "You just earned 3 months of detention. There's no such thing as Scotch-toberfest." And Willie's like, "There's not? You used me, Skinner! You used me!" It's like, how many jokes have we got there? It's joke after joke after joke, shotgun one after another. Each of them is funny, and each of them has several layers of comedy. The fact that Willie, the Scotsman, doesn't realize that there's such a thing as Scotch-toberfest. The fact that Skinner looks like sad at the fact that he's angry at him. And then, you know, obviously you got other examples, like the fact that Homer had to do a mock meltdown scenario and actually caused a literal meltdown. And then Mr. Burns runs to an escape pod that has two seats and locks Smithers out. And he says he likes to put his feet up. The escape pod shoots out and fails immediately and rolls down the hill. And then Homer crawls out and his radioactive monster must destroy world. Ooh, lunchtime. And then just goes back to normal. And then to top it off, the guy's like, "I don't even know how he caused the nuclear meltdown. There wasn't any nuclear material in the truck."
Like... Oh, that Mahler, yeah. You showed me that episode.
Yeah.
I think you showed me that one, and that was funny.
Classic Simpsons, yeah. Man.
That's good. What I mean is, like, in 3 minutes of Simpsons, we've got not only more comedy, well, not more, we not only have a higher quality tier of jokes, but several of them, one after another. And when you watch that, and then you go to BoJack, where the jokes never ascend beyond really long run-on sentence or a pun.
Have we talked about how it's like, let's address the elephant in the room, and then it pans out, and there's an elephant that goes, "You talking about me?" And they go, "No." He goes, "Well, you said elephant. Like, we're not talking about you."
He's like, "Wow, okay. Wow." He's doing that whole thing.
That joke. Then you have you all behave like vultures, lemon? And then it pans over, vultures, and there's two vultures that go, "Do you think he was talking about us?" You go, "No, I think he was talking about everyone else."
There was another one where it's like, agents are like lemmings, and there are a table of lemmings sitting next to them who get into
this joke over and over and over and over and over, and it's never fucking clever. Good job, you have animals in you. Oh shit, I've just remembered the thing.
We haven't talked about that. Oh, yeah, no. So in the BoJack universe, humans and animals are all basically humans and live together. There's an episode where... So what you need to understand about BoJack is it's a universe where humans and animals are equivalent. They're all humans, but basically the animal, you know, it's just like a chicken, but with arms and legs.
Yeah, they're all humanoid.
Or a dog with arms and legs. Yeah, they're all humanoid. And there's an episode where... there's an ad for Chicken for Days, which is basically KFC, where they're talking about eating chickens. And of course, your immediate question is, wait a second, aren't chickens also human beings, basically, eating chickens? Like, And then and of course that's already bad enough, but then there's a farm guy who's like an he's like a free range chicken farmer, and he's a chicken himself. He's like, you know, chicken for days, you know, they keep them in coops, that upsets me. Here at our something farms, you know, our chickens can run freely. And of course his son is like, but we're chickens. Wait, what? And he's like, it's okay. You see, when the chickens are born, they're injected with a drug that suppresses their brains, so it's okay to eat them. That's like the point, that's like his argument. So it would be akin to in our universe, a place that sold human flesh. And when somebody was like, what? Isn't this wrong? He's like, no, it's okay. When they were babies, we injected them with a mind suppressant, so they're stupid, so we can eat them and it's all good. Like, that is... And of course, I think this, while we were up to this season, I was still on the show's side, so I just basically was telling more like, I know it's stupid. You just got to pretend it doesn't exist. Unfortunately, the show doesn't pretend that it doesn't exist, because in a later season, Diane eats some chicken from Chicken for Days, despite being involved in that episode of freeing the chickens. And it's like, oh, okay.
Yeah, she finds the practice disgusting and horrible, yet they apparently don't give a fuck. Because it's in Vietnam, right? She's just getting some food while she's pondering on, like, the reason why she's there, trying to get away from Mr. Peanut Butter and deal with a divorce. And she just picks up some Chicken for Days chicken, and between scenes, she eats all of it. And you're like, Jesus Christ, show. Yeah. Like,
well, it's funny, because people are like, that's the joke. And it's like, guys, this universe is broken. It's a universe where apparently people are cool with eating the equivalent of human beings just because they had a brain suppressant when they were babies. It's insane.
People saying that's the joke. What do you mean?
The joke is that everybody in this universe is insane and cool with eating human flesh because they had a brain suppressant when they were kids.
It's funny because they're cannibals. You're like, yeah. Okay.
And then there was a later episode where they're in a restaurant and there's a picture of a humanoid pig up on the wall with the cuts of meat drawn onto it. And it's meant to be like a little funny joke. But again, it's like, this is horrifying. This would be like if you went to a restaurant and there was a human being up on the wall and they had like thigh ribs drawn on them,
yeah,
as they stood there. It's absurd. And that's the problem with this universe, is it really doesn't... And I think that's actually an interesting one, because while we were watching the show and I was still... It's supposed to be a social commentary on the brutality of slaughtering animals, but it doesn't work at all. Yeah, it doesn't work, because in our world, they aren't human beings. Like, that. So it's not a good analogy, if that's the point they're making. But yeah, this... I can't agree with the chicken criticism. I don't know what to say, man. I'm sorry. Like, you're just wrong. It's absurd. The underwater episode. So basically, to paint the picture, because obviously I recommended this show to Mauler, as we were watching it, we were getting up to about season three where things were starting to fall apart, because I was sitting here expecting stuff to come. Like, I was expecting things. I wonder what Fringy thinks about the South Park universe. The big difference between South Park and BoJack Horseman is that South Park doesn't rely on its comedy to set up drama. When you start using absurdist, ridiculous comedy to set up your drama, the stakes break. If anything can happen, you can't be invested in the drama. It just completely undermines it. And that's a big problem with BoJack, because there are instances where funny, absurd, random things are critical to the plot. But yeah, we were getting up to season three, and that's when it was starting to fall apart, because I was expecting stuff to happen. I was expecting the drama, and it just wasn't coming. And so then I think what I was saying to Mola was, we'll push for season three, episode four, the underwater episode. That's going to be the good one. That'll be the one where, you know, it'll be great. And we got to it, and we were watching it. And that is another episode that completely undermines, like, it's riddled with issues. BoJack never got told that there was a button on his machine that allows him to speak to people underwater. There are pens underwater that apparently work, but then it washes all the stuff away, which is super convenient because he needed to write something down on a piece of paper that was important to basically the fundamental point of the episode. BoJack only realizes at the very end of the episode that he can swim underwater, and it saves him from falling to his death. But in several other points in the episode, gravity works as though it's normal. What were some of the other issues with that fish episode, Mauler?
The fact that they do, again, it's for the joke. He walks into his room and he has a bunch of normal person stuff, but it's all floating around and fucking up because it's underwater. When that would, of course, be accounted for if it was an underwater world. So why? It's like, oh, look, all the chips are pouring out of the bag in the water. You're like, yeah. Why would you have opened them up in the water? Why wouldn't there be a place to eat? Why? This world is all fucking stupid. And of course, a lot of the bigger payoffs of the episode are all based on a lot of these really stupid things. Like, will he be able to get the baby back? It's like, this whole time he could have swim. He could have been swimming. There's so many moments where that would have been useful. Blowing up the taffy factory, he probably killed everyone inside there. Because it's an explosive, extremely sticky and hard to move taffy. Like, you're fucked. If you're surrounded by taffy, you can't do shit. You're just gonna die. So, and of course, they try and build some jokes out of it, but then they also have emotional payoffs, being that BoJack is taking care of something, and he finds some meaning in that. It wasn't lost on me what the point of the episode was. It's just incredibly poorly constructed. A lot of it is just fast and loose. They're just doing whatever they want to get at what they obviously are going for. And I just don't think that, if we're applying what we usually apply to narratives, especially ones that are building drama, that this holds up whatsoever.
Well, I mean, I see people talking about the whole mixing comedy and drama. So and this is interesting to me because I absolutely have the view that like comedy and drama can blend together, and work really well. I mean, obviously, because like a lot of my favorite shows are comedies that have drama moments in them. I think the fundamental thing that you have to avoid is having your comedy undermine the drama. So like a good example, right? Again, going back to The Simpsons, the reality is that Do It For Her, the episode where Homer meets his mom and then she drives away and he sits under the sunset. These are like more powerful than any moment in BoJack Horseman at all. Like, and these are only in one episode. But the fundamental thing is that there are no jokes or anything that's set up to undermine any of these powerful moments, right? There's no jokes that ruin these payoffs. Like, I mean, a good example, right? When Homer's mom is leaving, she smacks her head on the roof and says, "Dough." And it's like, that's kind of funny, but it works because she's Homer's mom. So it works on multiple... So the comedy doesn't undermine it. If anything, it enhances it. Like... And then, of course, you know, the drama itself is great. The drama is potent. It works. It doesn't undermine itself in any way. It makes sense. It's consistent. And whereas, you know, in BoJack Horseman, there are a lot of times where... Why are you comparing BoJack to The Simpsons? BoJack is widely regarded as being one of the greatest animated shows of all time, which means that there are some people who think that it's either on par with or better than The Simpsons. That's the reason why I keep drawing the comparison, because they're both animations and they're both predominantly comedies. And if The Simpsons is doing all of the comedy better and it's also nailing the drama, and BoJack's not doing either of those things, like, you know, what is there to say about that? It's a show that's trying to do... Oh yeah, and someone's just brought up Rick and Morty. Rick and Morty is appreciably funnier than BoJack. And more intelligently written, which is funny because you can't say that anymore, right? Oh, you gotta have a high IQ to understand Rick and Morty. It's like, yep, but Rick and Morty is funny and smart.
And a lot of people have been saying that everything you've been saying is a cold take. It's like, what are you talking about? BoJack is beloved. Like, every time I've ever heard anything about BoJack is that it's amazing. That it's incredibly funny and it's incredibly dramatic and it goes to dark places and explores depression in a really, like, detailed way, which, by the way... Oof, to that statement. Every last piece of development is rickety placed on all of these events that... To give you an example, BoJack has to deal with the idea that he essentially killed Sarah Lynn. Sarah. And a lot of people, you know, throw that claim around and he's stressing out about it. When, if you guys remember, the moment he's like, hey, let's do alcohol and drugs... She punches, or she doesn't punch, sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. She lifts up her calendar that has the counter for how long she's been sober, and behind it is this huge stack of alcohol, and she pulls it out and, you know, it's all ready to go. He goes to her house, and she smashes her, like, vase, and there's a bunch of cocaine in it. She'll punch her wall, and she's like, oh, is this my heroin wall? Oh, where's my heroin wall? it's all played for jokes about how she's absolutely, you know, running into drugs headfirst. And then the show's like, but she died. And you're like, oh shit, we're doing this? Okay, fuck, okay, yeah, this is getting real serious. Okay, yeah, I guess repercussions, you know, consequences, you can't just... LOL, spaghetti is falling off the water village. You're like, oh, okay, all right. I don't know where we go.
Yeah.
And then 3 seasons later, Sarah Lynn died because of you, BoJack. It's like, oh shit, wow, I don't know, man. And for a lot of people, they remember BoJack as an incredible drama that has a lot of commentary on, like, the human mind sort of thing. I think they forget that 90% of the show is shit jokes. Like, it's a seriously huge amount.
For instance, in season 4, we spend a very long time on Mr. Peanut Butter running for governor, and all of it is ridiculous. Like, apparently he can challenge him to a ski race down a mountain, and whoever wins will become the governor. But Todd, through contrivance, falls through the thing first, and everybody's like, oh, you are the governor. It's like, oh my god, like, what is this? And then they have an episode where they're doing fracking on Mr. Peanut Butter's house. His house falls into the ground. They spend like 3 days locked down there. The governor of California digs down to get them out. But they all go hip hip hooray, and then the cave that he tunnels down falls down and crushes his hands, and then Jessica Biel set Zach Braff on fire, and then they consume his meat, and then they prepare to do the same to Mr. Peanut Butter, and they're like, we'll never talk about this again. But then Jessica Biel tries to run for governor of California, and they're like, how do we stop? How do we prove she's insane? It's like, guys, she killed Zach Braff and ate him. Just say that, and it's over. The show, like, forgets so much of what's happening. Yeah. Like, so much of what actually happens in that show. Todd. Well, you had some strong opinions about Todd.
There you go. Like, these are jokes. What the fuck? When can we throw this out in defense of TLJ? Hey, the jokes you don't like, they're jokes.
It was a joke that they did the hyperspace kamikaze. That was a joke.
Well, no, I guess a better example would be Luke threw his lightsaber over his shoulder. That was to make you laugh. That was a joke.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't really help, does it?
Todd. Talk about Todd.
Todd could be deleted from the show. I don't see what the fuck he adds. He goes on adventures so much, the show gets self-aware about it. Like, fucking, isn't he like season 1? They're already talking it out, but then nothing really changes. They add that he's asexual about, what is that, the end of season 3 or 4?
End of season 3, yeah.
Simultaneously, he's ended his relationship with BoJack of 5 years of leeching off of him. And then, he, like, fails to remember that detail. Most of the time, he sees the relationship as he was, you know, taken advantage of or partially abused by BoJack in a friendship that just wasn't worthwhile, when it, like, blows my mind constantly. But the asexual thing, the show has no idea what it's doing with it. Like, there's a lot of these really crazy plot lines just involving... they try and draw him into a psychopathic adventure where he builds a roller coaster theme park that would violate every single... health and safety and IP convention you could possibly think of, and then he goes to jail for it, and then the Hollywood sign piece drops on it, and he escapes, and he'd be a wanted felon, but it doesn't matter, we'll just forget about that, even though jail plays a huge part in the finale for the show for a certain other character. You see, it's a joke one time, but it's incredible important development and dramatics in the other, but that's fine. It's fine. You're supposed to know when to laugh and when to cry, basically. Like, that's how it works. But, like, the girlfriend that he kind of has but kind of doesn't, they drop a few, right? Is there 3 in total of his girlfriends?
So, there's the first woman, Emily, who is not asexual, who there's a thing going on there, but that's how Todd figures out that he's not. And also, he's, like, very mad at BoJack for having sex with her, but he's not mad at Emily, that's her name, for actually, even though she's his... Like, yeah, it's totally lopsided. And again, like, the whole show is like, oh, BoJack, you're a bad friend to Todd. It's like, he let him live in his house for 5 years rent-free. Like, the show forgets that completely. Thoughts on Archer? Yeah, Archer is great, and it has better comedy and drama than BoJack.
I haven't seen it in a while, but I remember liking Archer a hell of a lot more than BoJack.
Yeah. But then, you have, then in the next season, Todd meets, somebody who is also asexual, No, that's at the end of season four. He tried to make a dating app for asexuals over the course of season four. Then at the end of season... BoJack was not a great friend to Todd. The problem is that the show ignores that Todd wasn't also a great friend to BoJack in a lot of ways.
The show trips over itself to punish BoJack. It never has a level-headed take on BoJack's existence.
So Todd makes an asexual dating app, and then he meets somebody who's also asexual. They start dating at the end of season four, and in the first episode of season five, they're already having issues because we've skipped massive amounts of time. Big issue in the show, they skip ahead by months and don't say anything about it and pretend like nothing has changed when they skip ahead by months.
You know what else we skip?
I'm pretty sure we
go from, oh man, Diane and Mr. Peanut Butter are having an argument that's a big one this time, and we skip to, well, the divorce papers are signed. Wow.
Yeah.
It's, oh yeah, someone said talk about how bad Diane is. Diane is like peak the badness of Britta from Community. She is that character.
Except not funny.
that's the thing. She can't even be... At least Britta was obliterated for comedy. Like, some of the stuff she does is funny, but Diane is, like, often framed as being correct. She chastises every other character for being wrong when she's one of the worst people in the show.
Well, yeah, because there was an episode where, Diane creates an elaborate torture chamber that BoJack has to go through because, there's a whole plot line of how BoJack went to New Mexico to meet an old friend of his called Charlotte. He got, you know, rejected by Charlotte. And so he almost initiated something with her like 17 or 18 year old daughter. It's all legal, but it's all, you know, it's bad, right? It's still like, and then a few seasons later, Diane finds out about a tape that has to do with her. But it's unclear, right? It's very unclear, what actually happened there. She has no idea whether or not BoJack's done anything illegal or whether he's done anything wrong. The context is missing. Instead of actually talking to him when BoJack is defensive, which he normally is, what she decides to do is rewrite a scene of the show that he's working on, to basically, force him to relive that whole scenario instead of just talking to him. It's like, oh, New Mexico, she's 17, kiss her, BoJack. And it's like, what, you're meant to be friends? Like, why would you talk to him? Why would you set up this elaborate torture chamber? And then like the show treats it like, oh, see, BoJack, you're a piece of shit. And it's like, Diane has no idea what actually happened, and she potentially like psychologically scarred BoJack for it, and the show treats it as if it's good. It's bizarre.
Let's not forget the difference on fracking between Peanut Butter and Diane is that he is forced politically to be pro fracking. He guesses she's very anti fracking, and so it gets into the news that the wife of the potential governor is anti fracking while he's pro fracking. She puts out an article about how bad fracking is and is causing trouble, and he condemns it for it. He's like, you're screwing up my whole campaign. And then she says, I've actually written an article about how bad you are. Like, an article all about how shit Mr. Peanut Butter is. And she's about to publish it. And it's one of the first, it's one of the three times in the entire show where he's angry. Which, by the way, would have been nice to have explored more of his character, but never mind.
Yeah.
And he's like, you can't do this. And then she hits publish, and then they hate fuck. And that's the end of the episode. And when I was watching with Fringy...
And they never addressed the fact, yeah.
When I was watching with Fringy, I was like, okay... Weird, but I guess I can understand a hate fuck. Like, all right, but man, like, this is gonna destroy his chances as governor. And I remember you being like, well, they don't. That article doesn't come up. It's like, yeah. What do you mean the article doesn't come up? It's like the whole cause of the huge drama between them is this article that apparently just dresses him down as this horrible person. It doesn't come up. It's gone. The next episode, it's the show used it for one thing and then forgot it existed. I was just like, wow. Fuck me for being invested in what's actually happening, I guess.
It's one of those things of this should be significant, but the show forgets that it is.
Another thing I guess we should bring up is you have the drama of Hollyhock abandoning BoJack. You'd be like, wow, that's a pretty big dramatic payoff. You get a lot of feels from that, and it fuels his drug and alcohol rampage that almost leads to his death. You're like, okay, that's big stuff. What is it based on? You're like, well, the relationship was damaged. Not broken. It's broken by one event. It's damaged by another event. We'll go with the damaged one first. You have BoJack in an attempt to reconnect with Charlotte, ends up taking her daughter to prom. But prom isn't working out, so he takes her and a couple of friends to drink a lot of alcohol. And unfortunately, one of the four of them get, like, way too drunk and have to go to hospital with her boyfriend. BoJack and Charlotte's daughter ditch them. This never... The boyfriend... Nobody talked about this. It never made it to the press, even though it's a huge story, and he went to a hospital. It very likely could have. But fine, I'll believe it. It all stayed under the carpet, all right? Now, this guy, he would have recovered from that situation. And years later, Hollyhock is just at a party, and she's struggling with the idea of drinking because of what she's seen in her father, which I think is pretty strong. It's like, yeah, that's good stuff. She's having a little bit of PTSD about, like, how, oh God, if she drinks something, she could become like him. It's like, okay, I'm following. And this guy turns up, and he's like, hey, I can help out. Say your name, like, count to a certain number, and you'll recover. And she's like, okay, good. And they eventually, they hit it off. They go up to her place. They talk about their experiences with alcohol. Turns out, this is the guy that BoJack abandoned after having given alcohol to... They are minors at that point, right?
The first story that this guy tells Hollyhock is about how BoJack... So what are the odds BoJack bumps into BoJack's sister in New York at one party, and the first story that he tells her is about how BoJack is a bad person? It's absurd. It's insane. This is the drama. This is the drama of the show. It kicks off the last season.
Well, I was going to say, so that's what damages their relationship. Someone said, nope, you didn't pay attention. You're right. They justified how those two happened to meet up completely. It wasn't just by blind fucking luck. it happened completely with cause and effect. So anyway, that's what damages their relationship. But how is it that it gets broken? Well, BoJack goes for an interview about what he's done in his past, and it goes really well. And he's so ego-driven on it that he wants to do another one. And despite Princess Carolyn being a very intelligent character, she just goes, fuck it, yeah, I guess you can do it. She'll quickly abandon him after this interview goes to shit. I was watching it with Fringy, I was like, this interview will go to shit. I'm curious how, but it will go to shit. They ask him a bunch of very personal questions. Questions that he was like, how the hell do you even know this information? They got it from his ex, what would you call him? The guy who leads the, Alcoholics Anonymous sort of place?
Yeah, the guy who was an Alcoholics Anonymous who are...
Right, well, this is where I'm going with it, right? So they got it from him, and you're like, whoa, why would he give up sensitive information? It's like, well, because he's drunk. Why is he drunk when he's the leader of, like, an anti-drunk group? Well, because BoJack got him drunk. You're like, BoJack got him drunk? How did BoJack get him drunk? Well, because BoJack had smuggled in a bottle of vodka as a sort of... You could maybe call it a safety blanket of sorts. So how did BoJack's bottle of vodka get to this guy? That sounds like a very difficult thing to write. It's like, well, BoJack accidentally dropped it in such a way that it bounced into a selection of bottles of water that were being delivered to this place, and that guy, before BoJack could run down the stairs and grab it, picked up that very bottle and drank the entire thing without realizing it was vodka. That's so, do you get what I'm saying, right? The big payoff, you follow exactly down to where it's all built, and it's on this broken as fuck narrative. It's absolute shit.
And that's kind of like, and then again, you know, talk about undermining jokes for comedy. I saw somebody mention the funeral episode, right? So like the funeral episode so BoJack's mom dies, and we haven't seen her since season 4. Like season 4, episode 11, we don't see her again until episode 6 when she's dead. And the whole episode is a big eulogy that BoJack is giving. And, you know, it's another one of those, this could have been a good episode, but we missed. Why didn't we get more scenes with the mum, for starters?
I like then, it. Wait, like, someone just said, he's an alcoholic, of course he realized it was vodka. As if that's the problem out of all of what I just mentioned.
BoJack's doing his eulogy. He does the whole thing. And then he goes over to the coffin and opens it and realizes it's not his mom. And he looks up and nobody he recognizes is there. It's a bunch of chameleons. So he gave this whole eulogy in front of a crowd. Like he was in the wrong building. And it's meant to be a funny joke, but it's like, wow, good job. You've undermined everything that you've just done there. Would the scene have not worked better if it was actually the real place and it was actually his mum in the coffin? Like, surely that would have been better. How could it have not been better? especially in reference to all of the stuff that he was talking about in that episode. The impromptu cancellation may have led to so much Russ nonsense and contrivance. Nah, season 5 is the worst season. And that was before the show got, you know, like its last season that they got the opportunity to work on. The show was broken before the end.
Molly, you said like, that was the problem. No, the problem is accidentally dropping this bottle in such a way that it lands in the selection of bottles of the ones that are being delivered to this guy, and he grabs the right one and then he drinks it. That's the main problem.
Yeah.
It's fucking absurd. And as much as you might be like, hey, absurdist comedy, it's like, what is absurdist drama where all of these stakes are built on absolutely insane contrived events so that we're just supposed to be like, hey, what if BoJack's ancient Egyptian cousin Ubatu wakes up from his crypt and steals his girlfriend? Isn't that dramatic? I'd be like, I guess so. Yeah. I guess that is dramatic. And you're like, Mueller's supposed to be funny! And I'm like, oh, fuck, sorry. I didn't get it, I guess.
Well, yeah, that's the thing is, if the comedy's not working in this show, which it isn't, at least it wasn't when we were rewatching it, there's not a lot left. Like, there's very little content, and the show wastes a lot of its time as well. There are so many episodes that could have stood to be cut. I like that picture.
Yeah, it's awesome.
There are so many episodes that could have stood to be cut out. Episodes that waste a lot of time. And it's all disappointing because what you have in this show with some amendments and with some tweaks, you have potentially a fantastic show. Like, again, The View from Halfway Down is a good episode on its own. It's a good episode on its own, and it's almost an episode that you could enjoy even without having watched the whole show.
It's wonderfully done in that it's a nice little dream sequence that I could believe he's having with himself until you realize a lot of the stuff they're saying subtextually matches events in his life. A lot of the visuals are telling you a lot about what's happening, and it all becomes very clear right toward the end that what it all represents, what it all means, and how it's all a big sort of goodbye to BoJack, and I think it would have been a way better season finale than what we got. The season finale was balls.
Yeah, the season finale is pretty terrible. If it had just ended there, BoJack dies, and that's just the end. It's a trick, you know, that is the end. It's just a surprise finale. I think it probably would have been better. And imagine how great that episode would have been if the rest of the show was as good as that episode. Like, it would have been one of the best episodes of television, period. But it's not. It's affixed to a show. It's affixed to a show that isn't nearly as good.
And that is hot take number two.
Yeah, that's the hot take on BoJack. I thought it was good and it's not. It's bad. It's really bad.
Well, I saw someone say like, oh, your hot take is that it's overrated? I was like, I guess you could say that. Jay actually put
extension.
Jay put a poll out asking, BoJack Horseman the show is good or bad? Good was 90%, bad was 10%. I would say that is incredibly overrated because it's absolutely a bad show. This is not what we want to be saying is even close to par. This is shit. And I find it kind of embarrassing, like, to watch sometimes that people wrote it. That's my hot take.
it does. It definitely, I feel like it's another one of those shows where there is no way that you could ever misinterpret anything to do with it, and the show benefits from that fact. The fact that you could never misunderstand what the show is about and what points it's trying to make, it seems to just help to have a show that does that, where there is no subtext, it's all text, it's all obvious, and you can never miss the point. That seems to be the way to do it.
Also, someone said, like, what is a show you guys like? Breaking Bad, go watch it. It's really good.
Yeah, how to go wrong with it.
I mean, obviously I like shows. Why would I be watching TV if I hated everything?
Well, no, I don't think that's what they meant. They were just like, hey, what are shows that are good then? And it's like, there's a lot of good shows out there. There's a lot of shows that are good in spite of their flaws. It's just, there's a lot of shows that are really, really overall shit. And, I thought BoJack Horseman was shit. I'm sorry, okay? Are you happy now?
The Clone Wars one go over? The Boy season 1, somebody mentioned.
Yeah, the boy season. Well, so I was gonna say, hey Metal Rags, Theo, how you guys doing? Are you okay?
I'm doing all right. Doing A-okay. I hadn't seen BoJack. I just saw that one episode that was terrible. So I didn't have really much to contribute to the discussion of the whole season as a whole. I hadn't seen a lot of bits and bobs scattered across.
Well,
you know,
I would hope what people can take away from this is that Fringy and I went through every single episode. We talked through everything about it structurally and from a comedic and dramatic standpoint. You can tell with the amount of references we've just gone through that we definitely know at least somewhat what we're talking about. May have screwed up some places, but it's a hot take. It's a take. It's not, you're not going to get much more than this at all. Like, if someone's looking for a debate on the Clone Wars or BoJack, it's going to be unlikely, because ultimately, like, I'm going to forget a shit ton of this show really soon, because, like, it's just not something that got to me on the heart tisms. But I wanted to let you guys know, because I know that a lot of you recommend BoJack Horseman, and, like, so you're going to be sad to hear about this, but hopefully you've not only got my response as well as Fringy's and a few other things here and there, but the reasoning, so you could take away from it what you will. It's not supposed to make you all sad, is my point. Okay.
Mm-hmm.